steps to life is opening God's word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for his soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change your life.
God's holy book, the Bible, is like a gold mine. It is filled with treasure. However, you have to dig it out. And the Bible talks about the fact that there are some things in the Bible that are like milk. Now, milk is food that a baby can eat. There are other things in the Bible that are referred to as solid food or strong meat that only mature Christians can study, and even they can't understand much of it. And most of the time in church worship services, we give people milk. That's what we do most of the time. Because there are people that come to church, there are people that visit churches that need to be saved and have never accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And if they don't get an opportunity in church, where are they going to get an opportunity? You're at a place right now where you could make a decision that could result in you having eternal life. We're going to look at some milk. You'll get some milk, but we're going to look at some other things too, things that are like solid food. And if you're not up to eating beefsteak in your Christian experience, you can just pass that by and take what you can digest and understand. Before we open God's holy book, I want to pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to read. If you would just bow your heads with me, please. Father in heaven, as we're now going to open your holy book, I pray for each person here. Lord, you know the trials, the temptations, the hopes, and the fears of every human heart. You know when we are lonely, when we are suffering mental anguish, and when we are discouraged. And we know that you have put in your holy book exactly what we need. And we pray that as we open it and read it, we will find what we need to learn and understand. For Jesus' sake, we ask it. Amen. We're going to start with some pretty hard things. But just stay with me. We'll get to some easier things in just a few minutes. When Jesus left, he told his disciples that he was going to come back and he was going to take them with him to where he was. Remember that? He said, don't let your heart be troubled because you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I will prepare a place for you, and I will come again. That's a promise. Jesus said, I will come again. Do you believe that Jesus always tells the truth? The Bible says that it is impossible for God to lie. Jesus said, I will come again. Now, he didn't say when he was coming. And so a lot of people have got discouraged because he hasn't come yet. But he says, I am coming. But before he comes, see, they didn't know that then. But before he comes, there are certain things that have to happen. And just before he comes, we're living in the last days, just before Jesus returns, there are certain climactic events that are going to happen. Let's read about a few of them. Let's go to one of the Old Testament prophets, to the book of Amos, and read what is going to happen. Now, if there's somebody here that gets scared when we read this, I'm not going to take away your fear. You just be scared. Because if you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're going to be scared in the future. It'd be better to get scared now and get saved than to wait until it's too late. Let's just read what the Bible says in Amos, the 9th chapter. It says in verse 9, starting in verse 9, because behold, I am commanding, and I will shake among all nations the house of Israel. Now that's God's people, the house of Israel. Just as one shakes with a sieve, but not will fall a single pebble to the earth. With the sword they will be killed, all the sinners among my people, who say it will not come near or come in front of us, the calamity. And then he goes on to say, the Lord says he is going to build back up the tabernacle of David, which has been breached and which lies in waste. He says, I'm going to build it back up as in the days of old. I hope you, if you're a mature Christian, you're a thoroughgoing Bible student, anytime you hear a preacher reading from the Word of God and he uses the word breach, that's a very significant word in the Bible. That's something for you to do a word study on. Understand what it's talking about. When the Lord, when a prophet says, the house of David has been breached, that's very serious. But we're not going to deal with that right now. That's for people that are experienced to study out. You can study that out on your own. Notice it says that the time's coming when all the sinners in the house of Zion, all of the sinners among God's people, what's going to happen to them? They're going to get killed. Now when we start reading scriptures like this, always there are some people that get scared. And it's all right that you should be scared. Because the reason this is in the Bible is so that you can do something about the problem and so that you don't land in this category. Well, we've read one text in the Old Testament. Let's read one text in the New Testament. It's talking about the very same thing. Turned right to the beginning of the New Testament, to the book of Matthew, the 3rd chapter. The Lord says, I'm going to command, I'm going to shake among all nations the house of Israel like one shakes corn in a sieve. Turn to Matthew, the 3rd chapter. And this is the preaching of John the Baptist. Matthew, the 3rd chapter. And he says, starting with the 10th verse, I love to preach about verses 7 to 9, but we can't get way late in there. We have to start in verse 10 this morning. He says, and already the axe is set at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree not making good fruit is cut down and cast into the fire. Notice he's saying, telling you in verse 10 that the name, your name won't save you. You get it? Here's a tree, here's a bunch of trees in a grove, and maybe it says, these are prize peach trees, or these are select apple trees, and the name is right on it. But the caretaker comes out, and these trees aren't bearing any fruit. And what is he going to do? What does it say? Going to cut them down. You see, there's lots of people in the world today say, oh, I'm a Christian. I believe in Jesus. What did John the Baptist say? That's what they were saying back then, too. You read the previous verses, and he was saying, don't even call yourself that. They were saying, oh, we're the children of Abraham. We're God's chosen people. And John the Baptist said, you better think again. The axe is laid to the root of the tree, and if the tree doesn't bear good fruit, it's going to be cut down. Doesn't matter what its name is. Do you realize, friends, that the Bible teaches that the great majority of the people who call themselves Christians in the last days will be lost? Do you realize the Bible says that, teaches that? Read it in your own Bible in Matthew 7, 21 to 23. It's clear. Those people it's talking about there, if you study the context carefully, it's not talking about the atheists or the infidels. It's talking about the Christians. And notice what he says is going to happen. Remember what Amos said? He said, the Lord says, I'm going to command and I'm going to shake like person shakes something in a sieve. Look at what John the Baptist says about this. Verse 11. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but there is one coming after me who is stronger than me, stronger than I am, of whom I am not worthy to bear his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Now, that's strong meat, by the way. In fact, it's so strong that there were a whole bunch of scribes copying the New Testament manuscripts, and they couldn't understand that either. And so the words and fire, they just left that off, because they couldn't figure that out either. They just left that off. In fact, in the majority of Greek manuscripts, the word fire isn't there, but it was in the original. It says in verse 12, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the storehouse, but the chaff he will burn up with fire unquenchable. Well, that's kind of scary too, isn't it? Let's look at one more difficult thing that you people that are experienced students of prophecy can study out on your own, and then we'll get to some things that are a little easier. As we approach the end, we're looking forward for Jesus to come, and when Jesus comes, it's going to be an exciting, wonderful day if you're ready. But certain things are going to happen as we draw close to the end. As we draw close to the end, there are two separations that take place among God's people. And it's clearly spelled out in Bible prophecy. And we read some text just now from both the Old and New Testament about it. One separation is the separation of the wheat and the tares. Now, some people are so naive in their thinking that they think that the separation of the wheat and the tares occurs when Jesus is in the clouds of heaven, but that's not actually the way it is. The separation of the wheat and the tares occurs at the end as we approach the end of probationary time. That's when it happens, at the end of probationary time. That's not our subject, though, right now. We're going to look at the second separation. We're going to study this for a few minutes. There's a second separation that takes place. Not even the separation of the wheat and the tares, but the wheat itself is going to go through a separation process. And this is scary. Here you have only wheat. The tares aren't even in it. This is a separation process that takes place only with the wheat, not the tares. John the Baptist talked about it. He said, the Lord has a fan. I remember when my father and mother, my brother and I, were missionaries in a heathen country called Myanmar today. We saw a lot of interesting things there that you don't see in the United States because it was a heathen country. We saw prayer wheels. You ever seen a prayer wheel? Prayer wheel is a little machine, and you can look at the inside, and they have written down prayers, and then you put it inside this thing, and it has a handle on it, and you spin it. And I mean, if you get to spinning that thing, you can say thousands of prayers a minute. Just they do that. I've seen them do it. And I've also seen them do sifting, interesting, without any equipment except just a round flat, like a platter. And they take the wheat and they throw it up. And while it's up in there, they... Boy, the chaff just blows out, and then it falls down, and they throw it up again, and chaff blows out. Pretty soon, they got all the chaff out of there. And John the Baptist said, the Lord has a fan, and he's going to turn it on to high, and the chaff's going to be blown out. Well, now let's think this through just a little bit. Let's get to something. We've been talking in symbolic language, right? Let's explain exactly what we're talking about in such simple language that a little child that's just learning to talk can understand. Number one, here we're going to explain it. Listen, what does the wheat represent? The wheat represents the people that are going to be saved. Is that right? And by the way, the wheat has something very valuable inside. Inside that wheat kernel, there's at one end of the wheat kernel, there's a little tiny germ, we call it. And that germ has life in it. And if you take a kernel of wheat that has the germ in it and you put it in the ground, you know what will happen? It'll sprout and it'll grow. It has life in it. But the chaff doesn't have any life in it. You take the chaff and you put it in the ground, well, it'll be a good fertilizer, but nothing will grow. What does the chaff represent? The wheat is easy to explain. The chaff is a little bit more difficult to explain. Obviously, the chaff are people that aren't saved. But let's explain it in a way that's easy to understand. Here's the easiest way to explain it that I have found. This is from Volume 5, Testimonies of the Church, page 227. No outward forms can make us clean. No ordinance administered by the saintliest of men can take the place of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Remember, John the Baptist said, the one that's coming after me is going to baptize you with what? With the Holy Spirit and with fire. The Spirit of God must do its work upon the heart. All who have not experienced its regenerating power are chaff among the wheat. Did you get it? Remember, the wheat has a germ in it, and it has life in it. Chaff doesn't have life in it. What's the chaff? Oh, friend, if the Holy Spirit has not brought spiritual life into my life, has not regenerated spiritual life into my life, then I'm chaff, even if I go to church. Now, just so that nobody will think that I just read something out of a book that wasn't Bible, let me just read that to you from the words of Jesus, just right out of the Bible in plain, simple English. If you do not experience the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit in your life, you're chaff. Is that simple? Is that easy to understand? If I have not experienced the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit in my life, I'm chaff. Let's read it. Open your Bible to the Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter. This is Jesus talking to Nicodemus. Look at verse 3. John 3, verse 3. Jesus answered and said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, except a person is born from above, it is not possible for him to see the kingdom of God." Well, Nicodemus got sarcastic. He said, "Well, what am I supposed to do? Is a man supposed to enter the second time into his mother's uterus and be born?" That's what you see in verse 4. Look at Jesus' response. Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, except a person is born of water and what? The Spirit. It is not possible for him to enter into the kingdom of God." Notice carefully what Jesus said. Did Jesus say he should not enter into the kingdom of God? Did he? No, he didn't say that. What did he say? He said he cannot. It is impossible. If I have not experienced the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit in my life, I'm chaff. And one of these days, friends, the Lord's going to turn the fan on. And the chaff doesn't have life in it, and it's going to blow away, and the wheat's going to stay. So I just want to ask you now a question. You don't need to change the expression on your face or raise your hand or do anything. Just think. This is the question. Have you received the Holy Spirit? Well, somebody says, Pastor John, that's a hard question. How am I supposed to know? I'm reading right here in John 3, and Jesus told Nicodemus, you can't see it. It's like the wind, you can't see it. Nope, can't see it. But it's a question that you need to know the answer to. If you haven't experienced the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit in your life, are you going to be saved? Not in the condition you are right now. Are you thinking? Have you received the Holy Spirit? Do you know that you have? How can you tell? Well, first of all, let's look at a few indicators. Indicators. You know what an indicator is? Surely I can't be the only person in this room that has at some time in my life been interested in flying, and when you're in an airplane, you have all kinds of indicators. We call them gauges. All kinds of indicators. And if you know how to read those indicators, you can go straight to your destination even if it's nighttime or if there's clouds in the sky. You don't need to see anything. Just look at those indicators and you'll know where to go and what to do. You'll be on course. You'll be have the right airspeed, the right altitude, the right everything. If you know how to read the indicators and control your controls. What are the indicators that a person has received the Holy Spirit? We're going to look at that first. Then we're going to look at somebody. When we look at the indicators, there's going to be some people right in this room going to say in your mind, you're going to say, well, that proves that I haven't received it. Well, okay, if that proves you haven't received it, then we're going to show you how to receive it. But first, let's look at the indicators. If I have received the Holy Spirit in my life, there are certain indicators that will appear. Here is one. I'm reading from the same book I read from before. It says, the Spirit of Christ will be revealed in all who are born of God. Strife and contention cannot arise among those who are controlled by His Spirit. Well then, if in my family we're fighting all the time, what does that mean? We haven't received the Holy Spirit. Oh, no. We haven't received the Holy Spirit. We may go to church. We mean all kinds of things about theology. But if we are fighting at home, one or more people haven't received the Holy Spirit. Because when you receive the Holy Spirit, you don't have that going on. Let's read it in the Bible. Look in Ephesians, the 4th chapter. By the way, this will not only show you that how we grieve the Holy Spirit, it'll show us that this strife and contention is aroused very often by the way that we speak to each other in our homes. The way we speak to each other at home reveals whether we've received the Holy Spirit or not. Let's read it. Ephesians 4, every rotten word, let it not go out of your mouth. But what is good for the building up of those that hear, in order that it may give grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by which you are sealed unto the day of redemption. All bitterness and wrath and anger and crying out and evil speech, put it away from you with all malice, and be kind to each other, compassionate, forgiving each other, just as also God in Christ forgave you. Okay, let's read one more. Look in James, the 3rd chapter, starting with verse 13. It says, who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by his good manner of life his works in gentleness of wisdom. But if you have jealousy, bitterness, strife in your hearts, do not exalt over and lie against the truth. This wisdom is not coming down from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where there is envy and contention, and there also is confusion and every evil thing. But the wisdom that comes down from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, yielding, full of mercy and good fruits, not partial, without pretense. Those are indicators. The way we live, the way we speak, especially at home, reveals whether we have received the Holy Spirit or not. Because if the Holy Spirit has come into my life, if I have been born of the Holy Spirit, I will not speak like the devil anymore. Now, if that's too plain, I'm sorry, but you understand? I will not, it's not just whether it's pure or impure or true or not true. It's more than that. It's, is it kind? Do you know, friends, wherever you live, whoever you live with, they could stand a little kindness? They could. Most people could probably stand more than a little. And if I receive the Holy Spirit, I'm going to be sensitive to the way other people feel in my family. You know, when Jesus was here, the little children were so attracted to him. It says in one of the Gospels that they came and they sat on his lap and he embraced them. What does that tell you? Do little children just naturally go and sit on somebody's lap that is angry and gruff and coarse and overbearing and shouting and nasty and all of that? Do little children come and sit on their lap? No, they don't. All those are indicators of whether or not I have received the Holy Spirit. If I have strife and contention at home, one or more people at home have not received the Holy Spirit. Because when the Holy Spirit comes in, it says in the Bible that the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace. Oh, friends, there are so many homes, there are so many marriages that are about to break up, that if one or more people in that home would pray to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm surrendering myself to you, I want to receive the Holy Spirit, something could be changed. Well, let's go to that. We talk too much about what the indicators are that we've received the Holy Spirit. Some people get discouraged. So let's go and find out whether you have received the Holy Spirit or not. There is a way that you can receive the Holy Spirit. There is a way that you and I can receive the Holy Spirit. Let me read to you just one paragraph from the book Desire of Ages that explains it in very simple language how it's done. Here's what it says. While the wind is itself invisible, it produces effects that are seen and felt. So the work of the Spirit upon the soul will reveal itself in every act of him who has felt its saving power. When the Spirit of God takes possession of the heart, it transforms the life. Stop right there for just a moment. Let me ask you a question. This is just a personal question for you to think about yourself. Does your life need to be transformed? Well, my life needs to be transformed. I'm never afraid as a pastor, when somebody comes to me and says, I am so bad and I've committed so many sins and I'm so awful that I just don't know if there's any hope for me. I know there is hope for that person every single time. Because they know that they're in trouble and they have a need. I'm not worried. I'm not worried because I serve a God who has in the heavenly sanctuary above a person by the name of Jesus Christ who is an all-powerful mediator. And I want to tell you, friend, as long as we have an all-powerful mediator, if you are the worst sinner in this room or the worst sinner in this town or in this state, doesn't matter. You can be saved. If you'll open your heart up to Him and surrender to Him, you can be saved. That's not the person I'm concerned about. The person I'm concerned about is the person that says, I've never robbed a bank, I've never been involved in crime, I've never gotten in trouble with the law, I'm a pretty good guy. That's the person I'm concerned about. You know who those people were in the Bible, in the New Testament? They were a group of people that you have heard about called the Pharisees. And the Pharisees came to the temple and Jesus quoted what one of their prayers was. And he said, Lord, I thank you that I am not like other men are. They're extortioners. And adulterers. Or even like this tax collector over here, this guy that works for the IRS, I'm not even as bad as him because I fast twice a week and I pay tithes of everything I possess. See, those are the people that are in trouble. Jesus said that the publican who was there, the tax collector who was there, that he wouldn't even lift up his eyes to heaven because he was so ashamed of himself and of his many sins. And he said, Lord, be merciful to me. I'm a sinner. And Jesus said, that tax collector went back to his house, he was forgiven, and the other man was not forgiven. So don't think, friend, that you're so bad that the Holy Spirit can't transform your life, because the Holy Spirit specializes in impossible cases. Let me just tell you something for your encouragement. We looked at this in the Bible just last week, so we're not going to spend time on it again. But I'm just telling you in passing for your encouragement, the Bible teaches very plainly that we are all impossible cases, but the Lord specializes in that. From a human point of view, we're all impossible cases. None of us can be saved from a human point of view. We can only be saved by divine power. And the sooner we find that out and yield ourselves to the Lord, the better off it will be. Here's what happens when the Holy Spirit comes in and takes possession of the heart. Sinful thoughts are put away. Evil deeds are renounced. Love, humility, and peace take the place of anger, envy, and strife. Joy takes the place of sadness, and the countenance reflects the light of heaven. No one sees the hand that lifts the burden or beholds the light descend from the courts above. The blessing comes when? Would you like to know that? Would you like to know when the blessing comes of the Holy Spirit taking possession of your heart and mind and working a complete change in your life? Would you not like to know when that happens? Okay, listen, this is when it happens. The blessing comes when, by faith, the soul surrenders itself to God. Is that complicated? It's not complicated. It's just hard to come to that decision sometime. Because human beings want to be in control of their own life. And sometimes God has to just let them go and say, okay, you can take charge of your own life. See how you can run it. You ever seen anybody that decided they want to do that? I remember. I knew a young man. He's still alive. I knew his parents. I knew his two sisters. Knew his relatives. They lived in eastern Washington.
And this young man came to a point and he said, I don't want to be a Christian. I'm going to be a good person. I just don't want to be a Christian. Well, I thought, that's really interesting. Because I had done a little reading by that time. And I had read an inspired source that inside of every human being, we have a bent to evil, which by ourselves we cannot resist. And I thought, that's interesting. Inspired writings tells me that in my heart that I have a bent to evil that I cannot resist by myself. And here's a person that says, I'm not going to trust in the Lord. I'm going to run my own life. I'm just going to be a good person. Let's see what happens. Well, you know what happened. He found out that he couldn't be as good a person as he wanted to be. He messed up. And oh, friend, there's somebody here today, and you've been in charge of your life, and you've said, oh, I'm going to be a good person. I want to do what's right. I'm going to be a good person. And you found out that you're not very good at managing your own life. You know what you need? You need to surrender your life to the Lord and say, Lord, I've messed it all up. I'm willing for you to be in charge of my life. Do you know, in the New Testament, Jesus is not simply called a Savior? Let's read it. Look in your Bible, in the day of Pentecost, in Acts the second chapter, Peter's preaching. Now these are the people that have crucified Jesus. They're as guilty as sin itself. They have crucified the Son of God. They're offered pardon on condition. Now here's the conditions. Acts 2, starting with verse 36. Therefore, most assuredly, let all the house of Israel know that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus that you crucified. Notice, he has made both the Lord and Christ. You know what a Lord is? Now, people in the United States don't know what a Lord is, but let me tell you, people in the Roman Empire knew. There's about two-thirds of the people in the Roman Empire were slaves, and they knew what a Lord was. And Jesus is not just a Savior from sin. He cannot be just your Savior from sin unless you are willing for Him to be the Lord of your life. And that's the problem with modern man. People say, I want to run my own ship. Well, the Lord will let you do it if you want to. Do you need to mess up for your whole life? Or are you willing to learn from others' experience that we are not able to do it? Choice is up to you. You want the Holy Spirit to take possession of your heart? When does it happen? Here's when it happens. When by faith the soul surrenders itself to God, then a miracle starts to take place. Verse 37, Acts 2. And hearing, they were stabbed in their heart, and they said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, what shall we do, men, brothers? And Peter said to them, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. How are you going to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit? If you acknowledge Jesus as both Lord and Christ and you repent of your sins and you're baptized, Peter says, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Do you want to receive it? There's the conditions right there. Acts 2, 36 to 38. Let's read a few other scriptures. How can you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit? We just read it, Acts 2, 36 to 38. Notice what Jesus said to his disciples about it in John 15. It's John 14. Starting with verse 15. This is Jesus speaking to his disciples. His subject is the promise of the Holy Spirit. And here's what he says. If you love me, keep my commandments. Remember, he is the Lord. And I will ask the Father, and he will give to you another comforter, that he might remain with you forever. the Spirit of truth, which the world is not able to receive, because it doesn't see him, neither knows him. But you know him, because he remains with you and shall be in you. And Jesus knew. The disciples, he just told the disciples that he was leaving. And it's just the same. It was just the same as if a father tells his children, I'm dying and you're going to be without me in a little while. And Jesus said, I'm going to leave and you're going to be without me. And they said, how are we ever going to endure this? And notice what Jesus said to them in verse 18. I will not leave you orphans. You like that? I will not leave you orphans. An orphan is of somebody that their father has died or their mother has died. But Jesus said, I'm not going to leave you like orphans. Well, how is he not going to leave us like orphans? Well, he explains how. I am coming to you. What does he mean, I'm coming to you? He's going to explain here. Yet a little while the world does not see me anymore, but you see me, because I live also you will live. And that day you shall know that I'm in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. The one having my commandments and keeping them, that is the one who loves me, and the one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas says to him, not Iscariot, Lord, how is it that you're about to manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone love me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our dwelling with him. The one not loving me does not keep my words. And the words which you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me. Do you notice in this passage of Scripture that if I want the Holy Spirit in my life, Jesus links up obedience to his word, to his commandments, with receiving the Holy Spirit? This is the great reason, friend, that the Christian churches today do not have the Holy Spirit. They have another spirit, but not the Holy Spirit, because they will not listen and obey this Scripture. This is not the only place in the Bible where this is. If you want to receive the Holy Spirit, you need to make a decision to surrender your heart to God and follow and obey Him. Notice what the apostles said about it in Acts 5. Acts 5. It says, it's a wonderful scripture in verse 31. Let's just read verse 32. It says, and we are witnesses of these words, and so is the Holy Spirit, which God gave or has given to those that what? That obey Him. Oh, friend. How do you receive the Holy Spirit? We've said it simply. Number one, have you surrendered your heart to God? Have you said, Lord, I'm willing for you to be in charge of my life. I'm willing to follow you. I'm willing to obey you. I won't be in charge of my own life from now on. I'll follow you. I'll surrender to you. And then actually do it. And then actually, somebody says, Pastor John, I can't. Of course you can't. That's why you need the Holy Spirit. Romans 8 teaches us that it is through the power of the Holy Spirit that a person overcomes sin. We can't overcome sin. That friend of mine that decided he was going to be a good person, just wasn't going to be a Christian, he changed his mind. He found out that he couldn't be a good person by himself. He needed help. Now, we're going to go to the last point that we're going to study. Remember what we started with? We started with reading text of Scripture that talked about a sifting and a shaking. There's going to be two separations. There's going to be a separation of the wheat and the tares, and there's also going to be a separation among the wheat, between the wheat and the what? The chaff. And the chaff is what? The people that have not experienced the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. They're going to be blown out. The wheat's going to be taken to heaven. Now, when this shaking and sifting is over, what is going to be left? Well, all that's going to be left is the wheat. And the Bible talks over and over again throughout the Old and New Testament about this. I'm finding more texts about it all the time. But I'm going to try to read four at least before we quit. This is our last point. But let's look first of all in the book of Isaiah, the fourth chapter. We need to read this. You need to make a commitment in your own heart with the Lord. Not with me, not with any person, but with the Lord. And say, Lord, I want to be part of this group. We don't have time to read the whole context. In Isaiah 4, the whole context includes the previous chapter. But in Isaiah 4, it's talking about this process by which God's children are going to be purified by a shaking and a sifting. And the tares and the chaff are all going to be blown out. And then it says in verse 3, and it shall be that the one who is left. Now, who's the one that's left? Oh, that's the wheat. The wheat's left. The one that is left in Zion, the one that is left in Jerusalem, will be called holy. Everyone written among the living in Jerusalem. When it's over, who's going to be left? Is there going to be somebody left? Yes, there's going to be somebody left. The holy people. That's where the word remnant comes from, those that are left. Do you want to be among these holy people when that's all that's left in the church? Do you want to be part of it? Are you willing to surrender your heart to the Lord so you can be part of it? Let's read one more text in the Old Testament about this. Look over to the book of Zephaniah. Zephaniah, the third chapter. And the 13th verse. It says, the remnant of Israel will not do iniquity and will not speak a lie, and it will not be found in their mouth a tongue of deceit. There they are again. That's the remnant. Let's look at a couple of texts in the New Testament about it. Look in Revelation 12. And the 17th verse. It says, and the dragon was angry with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, those that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. There it is again. There's going to be one. There's going to be a remnant. The Bible talks over and over again about them. Look at one last text. Revelation 17. And verse 14. It says, these, I'll just tell you the context, these is the worldwide confederacy with Antichrist. It's a worldwide confederacy. These with the Lamb shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, because he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those with him are called, chosen, and faithful. That's who God's going to have. You want to be part of that group? Those that are not just called, but chosen and faithful. Don't tell me, friend, I'm too weak. We're all weak. The Lord says, I have all the strength you need. He said to the Apostle Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. Don't say to me, oh, but I'm the chief of sinners, so I'm too bad. No. The Bible says, Paul says, I'm the chief of sinners, and Christ came to save me. And he did that to show an example of what he's going to do later with other chiefs of sinners. No, it's not that you're too weak because he has all the strength that you need. It's not that you're too sinful because he has all the grace that you need. It's your choice. That's what will make the difference. If you're willing to say, I'm going to surrender my life to God. I realize I can't manage it. I've messed it up. I'm going to surrender my life to God. The Holy Spirit will come into your life and make a change. Start changing right now. The Holy Spirit won't wait till tomorrow. He'll start working on your life right now if you're willing to make a decision right now. Are you willing for Jesus to be the Lord of your life? Remember, he's not the Lord of your life if you don't obey. He said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do what I say? That's what he told the people, Luke 6:46. Are you willing for Jesus to be the Lord of your life? If you are, and if you tell him so, you don't need to tell me. Just tell him. He knows what's in your mind. Say, I want you to be the Lord of my life. The Holy Spirit will come in and start to transform your life. everything will be changed. The Holy Spirit will enable you to do what you've tried maybe 1,000 times to do before and failed. It'll happen. Because it's happened to others. I'm not just talking to you. I've seen it happen. I know what I'm talking about. You want that change to happen in your life? If you do, before we sing our closing song, let's kneel down and pray that it'll happen. You cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm giving my life to you and I'll pray for you. Father in heaven, you have promised us that if we come to you by faith and we surrender our lives to you, that the Holy Spirit will come in and work a complete change so that we will not be among the chaff that will be blown out. Oh Lord, we know that we must receive that life-giving power from your Holy Spirit, or otherwise we're lost. We know that we cannot be saved in sin. But you have promised that Jesus can save us from our sins. You have promised that your Holy Spirit will be to us a power that will enable us to overcome all hereditary and cultivated tendencies to evil. Lord, I pray for anyone here that is discouraged, who has said in their heart, Lord, I don't know what to do. I've tried and tried and I can't make it. I pray that your Spirit, that your angels from heaven may give that person that power and grace and encouragement that they need. Help us to realize that there is no such thing as defeat if we surrender ourselves to Jesus, that he is equal to any emergency. And so now, I intercede for each person here as we cry out to you and as we say, Lord, help me. You have promised that if we say that, that we cannot perish, that divine power will come into our lives and give us all the help we need. We claim that promise and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.